around. God is great. No, you see all that stuff already. You see, when I say God is great, you say, don't hesitate. You say, this is a new one, Jersey. This is a new one. Why are you for that? Oh, but I was a true story. I was in North Carolina preaching. I had to be there for about 400 young people. The plane was delayed, so I couldn't make it to the conference on time. And then when I got there, I saw all of the young people, and there was an MC. And the MC was like, and something came over me. Like, I was really, like, P.O.'d. I was really upset because I'm like, your God is not this good. And if you're going to put that way, he's going to do it. So I got up on stage and I was like, already. So I knew that they needed fire. Amen? They need fire. So when I got up on stage and I'm like, oh, no, we're not doing this God is good thing. Right, we need to stop something. Like, you see, because my God is great. And when I said that, the kids were like, this is like, And then I'm like, but I didn't think about the next one. But you know the Holy Spirit is great. Amen? Right? Because at that point, the Holy Spirit said, and so I was like, God is great. And then we're like, ready for it. And I'm like, don't hesitate. I'm not kidding you. 400 people. They're like, ooh. They started applauding. Right? Because they were ready for it. And that's what I mean, you know, the nice girl, I don't know. But see, my God is not good. My God is great. Amen? See, that's what I'm talking about. Because you know what? My brother Jim just gave me that word. And I need to be reminded about that word. Why? Because he said, I've earned the Father's heart. You see, and I know that I am loved by the Father. Amen? You see, we have a good Father, amen? And we have a merciful Father, amen? You see, and I get excited about that. You see, I get excited because I know that I have a God that is not just me. My God is great. And this is why, church, we cannot hesitate. We cannot hesitate. It is time, church. It is time for us to wake up. It is time to wake up, which we can do. And we need to get it together. We need more. Amen? I don't know about you. I need more. Amen? I want you to look at your neighbor right now. Look at your neighbor and say, I need more. I need more. Okay, look at your neighbor. Now, I need you to look at your neighbor. I need you to look at your neighbor again now, and look at your neighbor, and I'm going to give you permission to say, you need more. Say, you need more. You need more. Okay? See, we all need more. We all need more, and God can give that. God can provide that. And this Eucharistic revival needs to happen. Amen. It needs to happen. And I am so blessed, right, because we're living in these times. Okay? These are faith-making times. Amen? Okay, let's be honest, right? Let's be very clear. The pandemic, right, when it happened, it hit us hard. But I don't know about you. I feel much stronger than this. I don't know about you. You see, God kind of pulled me off to the side, and he told me, I want you to go deeper. I want you to go deeper. And then the Lord did one of that, and he was talking to me. And he was speaking into my heart. And I never felt alone and abandoned. The only thing I felt was that I couldn't be with my mother and my father. That's what we really think about, right? I wasn't worried about me, right? I was not me, whatever. If I'm ready to go, let's go! If I confess, take me, Lord. See, but we don't speak like this. Like, we're kind of scared of death. And we shouldn't be. Because that's where we're headed. That's where we're going. Amen? And here's the thing. Why does death always catch us by surprise? Because if it catches you by surprise, it means you're not prepared. And you're out. You see, church, I'm going to teach you something tonight in Jersey you're never going to forget. Okay? And I learned this from a great Prince friend. He's in heaven right now, he's resting in peace. And when he dies, I said, I'm going to take it over now. So in my church in the South Bronx, you can't come to church and keep your mouth shut. It is forbidden. So when I preach, if I say something that's worthwhile, you say amen. Amen? But if I say something that stings or kind of hurts you, you say, ouch. Amen, ouch. You got to be able to decide. You can't keep your mouth shut. People, this is the problem. We come to church and it's like, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Peace be with you. Amen, ouch. It's true. Well, you know, this work. You know, for me, you know, I don't like going to Mass. Mass is boring. It's not good boring. Amen. Because if you come to church and you don't open your mouth and you don't sing and you don't worship, then guess what? You're not part of the solution. You're part of the problem. Because if all you do in Mass is you stand up, you kneel, you sit. You stand up, you kneel, you sit. You know, this is a problem. But when you understand what's going on, when you understand the reality of it, you say, wait a second. This is what heaven means to us. This is it. If I believe in the real presence of Jesus, you see, because if you don't believe in the real presence of Jesus, and all you're doing is praying for a little piece of bread and a little bit of wine, that's Arthur Avenue in the Bronx and get bread and wine. You see, because I don't come to church to get bread and wine. You see, I come to receive the real presence, the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus. Amen? See, this is the problem, Catholic. This is the problem. And then there was Santa. No, you know, I just go, I watch the Mass from my house. No, you need to get your lazy behind up. Put your damn clothes on and get out the house. Because that's why you're depressed. That's why you're anxious. Amen or out. Okay, being in your pajamas all day is not healthy. Alright? I'm being very serious. Now young people are walking out in the streets with their pajamas on. What is it, Halloween all year round now? Thank God there's something that's not healthy. You need to take the clothes off that you were sleeping in and put on your clothes. Amen? The Word of God says you need to put on the armor of God. Amen? You can't be walking around in your pajamas. What are you, SpongeBob? Like, seriously. And we're condoning this. We're allowing this. My dad would have slapped the Jesus out of me. Boy, go put some clothes on. You must be out your mind. Walking around in your pajamas. And now we're wondering why we're depressed. You see, because if you don't believe in the real presence, my sisters and my brothers in Christ, you have a problem. Jesus said, this is my body. This is my blood. It's not a joke. It's not a game. He's right. You see, this is the problem. And if you're Christian again, you're here. And excuse me. If it doesn't matter, you see, this is what I'm talking about. But you don't go to Mass and you don't receive Jesus, you need to check yourself. You need to check yourself. I'm going to go to the entire conference. I have to tell you a quick story about one of my favorite people. And her name was Victoria. And we met Victoria at my first college. I was a regular college priest. And Victoria had cancer. And the doctor told her she didn't have much cancer. And so I had this beautiful relationship with Victoria and her family. And the doctor called me one day. Jesus doesn't love us, and God, He uses you. I said, nobody does.
laughing, and they go, "What the fuck?" And she goes, "And she goes, Father, I'm just going to get me out of this job. We're going to need to get me some sisters." I keep telling everybody all of this.
You can't get out of that. That's different. But for you to be lazy,
Oh, what? The days ago? That's what I want to do. I'm going to do it. You know what God put in my heart recently? You know, even a couple of months ago, God put this in my heart. Gilbert, you're going to like this one. You're going to love this one, Gilbert. God put this in my heart. It's God's perfect. This record you hear is God's perfect. Amen? Amen? Remember, you can't keep your mouth shut. That's all. If God is perfect, okay, and God made the world, and God made time, you're telling me that God did not make enough time for you in a day? Amen or out? Amen or out? You see, this is God put this in my heart. See, we're I don't have enough time. Wait a second. God made time. So you're telling me that God is imperfect because you don't have enough time in a day? Who's the problem? You or God? I think it's you, buddy. No offense, right? Is everybody following, yes or no? Think about this. How many hours are there in a day? How many days in a week? I bet you a lot of you have never thought about this. What is 24 times 7? A lot. You can tell you're an iPhone user. Thanks, Siri. What's 24 times 7? I cannot believe how small we are as human beings, and none of you have done this math before. There are 168 hours in a day. Think about it. I mean, I'm sorry, in a week, I apologize. Okay? We have 160, 24 hours in one day. 24 hours in one day times 7, okay? 7 days times 24 is 168, okay? We do it on the little Obama thing there. Okay? There it is. All right? Good job, Bill. Thanks for being here, buddy. All right? There are 168 hours in a day, okay? I'm sorry, I said it again. In a week, sorry. 168 hours in a week, okay? How many hours can God ask us to go to church? And you're going to tell me with a straight face that out of 168 hours, you can't give God back money? We don't talk logic to people. Be logical. There are 168 hours, and we're going to tell you with a straight face. You can't find one easy hour to give back to your Creator. You can't at least 6 or 7 hours if your bishop tells you to speak for 3. I'm not joking. Pray for me. Tell me Jesus. You can rise from his name. You watch a baseball game. You watch a baseball game. You watch a basketball game. 2 to 3 hours. You watch a football game. Whole day of prayer. Because you got a tailgate. Right? You go to a birthday party. How many hours? You work 40 hours at least. If you watch the soap opera, if you're Latino, or you're watching a telenovela, you know what I'm talking about. Or if you're that person that still watches Days of Our Lives 45 years later, seriously, you know what I'm talking about. Is Dallas still on the air? No, right? Okay. Thank God, right? There is a God, right? what I saw with anyway. I'm in the series. But think about it. If you cook, how many hours do you spend in the kitchen? Let's talk about how much time you spend on your body, on your hair. And here's the crazy part. Here's the crazy part. You think, and my parents were used to this already. We preach. We're doing it. We don't do these little, 45-minute messages. We don't do that in the hood. And God forgive me, if I have to put my mom on the show. Seriously, they want the word, but they want you to bring it. Let's go. Keep it moving, Get out. Bam. Really? These are the good guys. So the guys who are here, they're going to be here tonight. Let's give them a round of applause. Oh, there's no priest. You can't catch them here tonight. Oh, no. They wouldn't call. They wouldn't show up. You know what I'm talking about. You know that's the truth. You see, I'm a bishop. I'm speaking into it. I'm supposed to teach the government to think about. So when we make the mass a routine thing, a right thing, and we don't believe in the real presence of Jesus, the pure of ours came to be the enemy. You can look at the Lord as he lifted up the Lord. You can look at the Lord with me. And people are converted. But if you're talking in the mouth, this is my body. Are we doing this? Here's the problem. It's not just about receiving Jesus in communion for myself, but it's being in communion with his mystical body. Amen? Okay, church, we do church bad. I'm sorry. I'm speaking into this right now. We don't know how to do church. What? If all you do is go to mass 45 minutes, and then open up the church. How are you being in community? How are you being in communion? We got to get out of this mentality, and I don't know where we adopted it. I don't know where it came from, but we have to get out of this mentality of get in, get the money, get out. Get in, get the money, get out. No! We can't do that. How many times do we come to church? We don't know the name of the person in front of me. We don't know the name of the person behind me. We got the person to my left and to my right. And then, show each other a side of peace. Amen. It's like a hug fest when you go to the Spanish now. Everybody's singing out. It's not hugging each other. You know, sometimes I gotta roll it back and I'm like, all right, we're focusing on Jesus. You know? But you got both extremes. Everything in moderation, people. Amen? Okay, I'm being serious. But think about it. If all we do when we go to Mass is just 45 minutes, an hour, and then I don't even say hi to anybody, I don't even introduce myself to anyone, I don't even speak to somebody and say, hey, how are you doing? Oh, you can thank you. Thank you. I know that God is doing wonderful things in my life. And this is something that we need to do better as church. We need to do this better as church. We need to be passionate about our faith. I know I'm not everybody's cup of tea. I know that. I understand that. And I'm okay with that because guess what? Different folks are different folks. It's all good. It's all gravy, baby. But you know what? Don't hit on me. Because if you drink the Haterade, that's your problem. You get it? So there are people, they get offended when you're overdrunk, when you're joyful, and when you're full of the Spirit, they want to jump it out of you. But you know what? You blew the shofar. We're in a war right now. Amen? We're declaring that. You see? It's a war. And we cannot be afraid. And listen to this. Pay attention. You don't have to write this one down. I know some of the priests are going to start using it. It's okay, fathers. It's all right. You know what? You know who the patron saint of good preaching is? Everybody? The patron saint of good preaching. Who? St. Dominic, my very good teacher. Oh, you're so Catholic. I love you. You ready? The patron saint of good preaching? The good priest. Yeah, you know what? Because when you hear something good, you steal it and then use it again. And by the way, I was told this by a Dominican priest. I was told by Father Peter Cameron, okay, the editor-in-chief of my teacher. He was my teacher. He's Dominican. And he said, Jesus, I don't like it. And this is very, very true. When people preach and they're like, what do you say? Oh, I'm a good idea. It ain't your idea. It's the Holy Spirit. Stop. It's God. And guess what? If this to edify the kingdom, go ahead. Use it. Because when people say, oh, you know what? They don't have a pocket of their time. No, not at all. Why not? And it's noise. It's silence. It's meant to be shared. You know, why are we so jealous? Why are we hating on each other? You're the material ain't original. It belongs to the Lord, amen? And so my sisters and my brothers in Christ, when we're speaking about this, right? When we're talking about the holy sacrifice of the Lamb, when we're speaking about the Eucharist, when one of us misses, when one of us is left around the table of the Lord, we become weakened. We need everybody to be healed. Everybody to come to the feet of Jesus. And we cannot be afraid of that. We cannot be intimidated by color. We cannot be intimidated by language. Everybody, by preferences, everybody. Jesus came to die for all. Sinners and saints alike. My sisters and my brothers in Christ, we're not born first wrong. You know the number one reason why young adults don't come back? When a young adult comes to the church, you know why they don't come back? It's not that they don't believe. It's not that they don't believe. It's that they don't feel that if they stop coming, anyone would kill them. Why? If I stop going to mass, nobody can. Who's that kind of problem? So what? And if you're all going just to preach, you expect to preach to know 1,000 people? That's not fair. That's not fair at all. I mean, why willing to preach for everything? You see, church, this is why we need to wake up and we need to play our part. Because guess what? If I know that Sarah's in the hospital, and Sarah sits next to me at church, then maybe it's my duty to go and tell Father, hey, Father, Sarah's in the hospital. Maybe you should go visit her. Notice what I just said. Not you go visit her. We go visit her. Amen or else? We're doing church wrong. We don't care. As long as I get my Jesus, as long as I say my prayers, and it kills me, because young adults are leaving the church and young people are leaving it. Wow! You know what? I get more calls from my gym than I do from people in my past. My gym membership says, hey, Joseph, you haven't been coming to the gym. Is everything okay? I know, but damn, you know? And I'm joking. I'm being very serious. I didn't go to the gym for 2 or 3 weeks in time. I say, where are you? Can you call me the people that go to the gym? Oh, you expect performance? You're expecting that? Can you stop to do that? Well, she gets paid. She's father's assistant. Yeah, but if she doesn't know, how is she going to do that? You see, we only need generally to care about each other, unfortunately. They're not out. You see, the world isn't going to change if we don't change. Pope Paul VI, one of my favorite quotes. The world wants witnesses, not teachers. And if you listen to teachers, it's only because they were witnesses first. Shall I repeat it again? I'm going to repeat it one more time. The world wants witnesses. The world listens to witnesses. And if they listen to teachers, it's only because they were witnesses. You want to know why the world is the way it is? Look at what's happening. Look at the education system. Both public and Catholic. Both. I'm not picking on one. Both of them. Look at the junk that they're teaching our kids. It's horrible. And whose fault is that? Whose fault is that, Sticker? Whose fault is it? Cowards! Because if we don't speak up, if we don't talk, if we don't say, hey, we gotta change the system, we can't keep doing business as usual. I love it. You see, he said to an interview, he said, listen, This is a three passages. I'm going to go back to the quote that the preacher is going to write down. Trust me. I have three passages. I'm passionate about God. I'm passionate about Jesus. Don't judge me, okay? And I'm passionate about young people. And I love young people. And they are so misunderstood. They are so misunderstood. If you were to understand young people, and if I understand young people, it's different. I know where they come from. I speak their language. As a matter of fact, I was having this conversation with Judy on the way down in my 2 hours, 40 minutes, right? All right? By the way, you never turn on the radio or music. We're talking about your time. Right? And we were talking about that, right? Language. So the basis of Loyola, whom I love dearly, the immigration and power. So the basis of Loyola, he said, you cannot evangelize if you don't speak the language. And that's why we're not getting a kids, because we're not speaking their language. We're not speaking what they speak. And this is important. Why? Don't tell your no. Jesus spoke the language of your day. See, when people introduce me to you, I say, you know what? I speak three languages. This is the problem. You don't understand where they're coming from. And we just, oh, well, you know what? Think about what I'm about to do. This is really very profound. What I'm about to do is very profound. Well, you know, young people are lost. Young people are hopeless. Think about this, man. You're not even realizing you're trying to blame on yourself. So there's someone who's going to help you. I've been dealing with a problem and not going to be a very big out. Because we're not talking about God, and we're not talking about the state of politics in our country. Stop the nonsense. We need to start talking about politics. We need to start talking about religion. This is the reality. In the lifetime myself, it wasn't Obama, it wasn't Bush, it wasn't Trump who died for you. His name is Jesus. You think God is happy with us right now and what's going on within the Catholic Church? You think God is happy right now between conservatives and liberals? You think God is happy right now with how we're divided as a country? We are polarized right now. And I need to speak into that because it is not of God. God's saying that we may be one. And I am not a Republican, I am not a Democrat, I belong to Jesus Christ. We need to stop. And by the way, let me come right up here because I want to speak where it matters most. Because everything revolves around the table of the Lord. Everything revolves around the Eucharist. And listen to me clearly. I don't care whether you like the Latin Mass or you like the Mass in German or in Spanish. It's the same Jesus. One Mass is not better than another. That is actually heresy. And there are people that are walking around, and even some of my brother priests, who are walking around and say, oh, you know, this Mass is better than that Mass. I don't care if you want to do an apostolic Mass in Latin. I don't care if you want to use the 25, you know, 1,000 print organ. Or if you want to, you know, bang on drums. The Mass is the Mass. Is the Mass. You know what? The best. It's not on the belly of speech. Why? And you can't keep, you know, condoning this attitude that we have of saying, you know, the English Mass is better than the Spanish Mass, or the Latin Mass is better than the Swahili Mass. It's the same thing. Thank you, sister, you're right. Just speak our languages. Because if you're living in God, then you have a problem. You have a major energy division within the church that is disgusting. It's polarizing. It's killing us. And without supporting each other, we're just going deeper down the road. We're just going deeper. You let me know. Let's keep it going, brother. You tell me when we stop. You tell me if I'm over. I don't even know. Okay? So listen, I can keep going. Okay? Keep it going. You tell me. You need a fight? I'm telling you. You tell me. I'm not even starting with my notes. Okay? So, that's real talk. That's real talk. You see, I let the Spirit flow. Okay? I'm not even starting with my notes. Because I'm just speaking from the heart right now. Because I got something to say. Amen? Because God is great. God is great. Y'all are a bunch of liars. Y'all were hesitating. Just now. Let's say that again. God is great. You need to tell that to your family. You need to tell that to your friends. Because my God is not just good. My God is great. And if you're grateful, you got to stop hesitating. Stop hesitating to proclaim the good news. Stop hesitating if you're waking up to go to confession. I don't understand how there's some Catholic church. Hey, Catholic, are you reading this? Yeah, but I don't go to confession. I don't know about that then. Am I right? Oh, Because the reality is that we are meant to receive the body and blood of Jesus. And this is what we're talking about with the Eucharistic revival lesson. Because this is tens of thousands from the chairman of the committee on evangelization and kind of Jesus, and Jesus, my brother, this is cousin. And he says this, he says, we want to start a fire, not a program. I love it. Yeah! We want to start a fire! And this wasn't me! He's been complaining! I mean, again, if you want us to revival, we need to start a fire! You guys know that one? Set a fire, then we must then I can control, then I can control. When we go in, when I go change, you better pray that night. Okay? My sisters and my brothers in Christ. Can you research something? It's something that came out in 2019. And it says this. There are 7 in 10 Catholics. 69% think that during the Catholic Mass, the bread and wine used in communion are symbols of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Only 1/3 of U.S. Catholics, 31%, believe that during the Catholic Mass, the bread and wine become the body and blood of Jesus. It's crazy. The devil is unbelievable. You know, and how do we react, you know, when we are here? And it's like, fine, you know, it doesn't matter. And then the new trend that has become with people, well, if you can't see Jesus, they will come up and do this. How can you bless you, Father? Tell me that the biggest blessing you see is you want confession, fix your life, stop living in sin, and you see Jesus. Maria, I like you a lot. Can I take you home with me? Okay, I like you a lot. All right, thank you, Maria. She's awesome. Okay? Okay, she says, if they stay to the end of Mass. Right? Remember, Maria's right. Because in the churches in Mexico, alright, they have signs outside towards the back of the church and it says, remember, only Judas left early. So you know what? You need to tell your family and friends. You know? There was only one who left the Last Supper early, and his name was Judas. And we know what happened at that time. Thank you, Maria. Okay? before you start, but I'm not going to take you on that. God, there is somebody, my sisters and my brothers in Christ, be with me, let me leave you with this, and I want to talk to you to do your homework. Go on the website, eucharisticrevival.org. Okay? EucharisticRevival.org. It is worth it. By the way, I have my Eucharistic Revival pin. Okay? If you put this is cousins, I have the pin on it. Okay, thank you. So I have my Eucharistic Revival pin on because I hope that it was some of the actual videos. And it's hard to go with it on some of these videos. So I'm not sending you to do something that is not going to be worth it. I want you to go on to EucharisticRevival.org. And this year, okay, I just want to say this really quickly. This year, last year, was the biological revolution, right? Last year, as a biology, we should have been talking about this Eucharistic revival. This year, now, is the polished level. So we should be talking about the Eucharistic revival in every part of the country. Now talking about it, doing something about it. For example, I will say this publicly. What am I doing this year differently? As a bishop, I'm still a pastor, by the way. So I don't want to hear excuses. I'm still a pastor. What am I doing this year? I'm catechizing every single ministry of the palace. So I'm meeting with every group. Every single group. I'm meeting with the Eucharistic ministers. I'm meeting with the lectors. I'm meeting with the Latina de la Vida. I'm meeting with the youth groups. I'm meeting with everybody. And I'm giving them, I will preach for myself, seven different topics, teachings on the Eucharist. It's a key. Now don't go home and crucify your pastor. You know what the bishop is doing? Don't call me, you don't have time. And let her out. Right, okay? Do not do that, please, because then I will be receiving more hate mail. Okay? I got enough. But seriously, on the local level, at the parish level, okay, we should be talking about these four points. These are the four goals of this year. And a lot of people don't know them, and it breaks my mind. Right? What are the four goals for this year? Goal number one. Reinvigorate worship. Now, this is the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, the USCCB. All right, let me clarify that. United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, it is out of the news. What is the USCCB? What is that? All right, that's what we call it affectionately in the church. We have all these acronyms, right? The United States Conference of Catholic Bishops has said, the church, and the church, we are the church. Who's the church? Let me teach you something one of the sisters taught me when I was in grade school. Ready? Spell church. E-H. Spell it again. Take off the first C-H. Take off the last C-H. What are you left with? You are the church. Isn't that true? You like that one, right? I like that one. Right? You are. You see, because what happens is that we start downgrading the church when we read in the hierarchy. And let it out. Out. Right? We know. We get it. We get it. But it's easy to criticize. But here is the hierarchy putting in place and saying we need to reinvigorate worship. What does that look like? Okay, let's dream a little bit. What does that really look like? If we were to reinvigorate worship, do I need to provide worship to you at my house? You guys are so blessed that you have TVs, screens here. I come back to my house, I get dreams in my head and TVs. You can't afford it. Because I have a roof falling in my head. You see? Hopefully, it's possible. Some of us can't even pay our electric bill. You see, that one is not correct. Did you ever think that my kids were not to be Eucharistic and Bible?
in areas in New York. We had one from the entire state of New York. We ordered four buses. They came from three of our buses. We came out. My people were waiting outside on the sidewalk, 175 people and 200. Wow, you got a bus. This is a reality, but we don't speak about injustice. And then here's the thing, my people are so good, my people are so awesome, I love my people. They set my heart, they understand the pastor's heart. But they were like, no, we're sending up the young people. They sent all their sons and daughters. And they're like, this is going to be a full lady, and we have just a bunch of like old elderly people who are going to take their bus. Because we know God, food, young people. They know my heart. And they did the right thing. They sent up the young people, right? Sent them up to Arizona. We had a great time up there, a beautiful, beautiful experience for them. They have never been in a city, they've never seen such a thing. Guess what? When they come back, as they're getting off the bus, I'm going to see you. With the point first, the same mechanism. The same mechanism. And what happens? You guys are blessed. Even if you are underneath the moon, with a beautiful building, you have angels. As I invited somebody in the last week to come to my house. As I invited somebody in the last month to come to my house. As I invited somebody in the last year to come to my house. And if you haven't, you need to go to confession. And now, because my friend Lucy is my faith, I'm going to be me. See, the last time I said, God has come. Do you, baby? You can't be you. You gotta worry about everybody. Because you became for everybody. So how am I gonna live the way it works? Maybe I don't know the same person from Madison. I should learn them now. Maybe I'm not listening to the prayers at night. I really believe this from the bottom of my heart. That if we as Catholics were to pray the Mass together, it would never change. You know what happens? Everybody comes in with a lame agenda. You come in and do the agenda. You come in and do the agenda. You come in and do the agenda. When we are new to the agenda, we just stop for him. But the thing is that we come in with our own agenda. We need to pray what the priest has prayed. You see, this is the problem in families. We need to do a better job of teaching. Just pray these prayers together. But it's a free to us. Father, I didn't even understand the rules. We need to pray together. One, reinvigorate worship. Two, personal encounter. Can we have a personal encounter with the living God? Because there are many Catholics who are comforted by reading. Young people, I'm telling you, I speak their language. Young people are not going to be Catholic because you're Catholic. Enough! Those days are over! Come on! Forget about it! We're not going to get back! They're going to be Catholic when they have an encounter. They're going to be Catholic when they have an encounter. And we need to stop being afraid of church. We need to stop being afraid. Yes, I know we've been through things. I'm not going to reopen old wounds because I think they've been opened way too much. But let's move forward. Let's move beyond that. You know, and I'm going to speak into it. Priests are being afraid to minister to young people, to the children. Fathers, we need you.
your father. We have a fatherless generation, or a three generations that have been fatherless. And we need to wake up. And I'm not going to speak into that whole thing right now, because that's another conversation. And how we treat men, and how fathers are being treated today. Second-class citizens. I'm not even going to go into that right now, because it's the truth. And I'm going to leave it right there, so we cannot say that we don't need men and we don't need fathers. It's a lie. It's a lie. We need to stop that. See, the pendulum has swung. You see, it's about extreme. And I'm a church historian. And like Pastor Bolin, we are both church historians. It's something that we share our passion about. And it's funny because we like to go like from one side all the way to the other. First, it was the whole machismo thing, men, and all that. So it's the women's rights thing, and feminism, and all that. So we have a balance thing. So can we bring the pendulum back to the middle? Because you know what? Both extremes are no good. I'm going to repeat that again. Moderation. Middle of the road. And this is what I really did talk. We need to help our young people. Listen, I'm going to say this, and I'm going to do it from the bottom of my heart, because I work with young people, I love young people. We should not be afraid to step into their messy ways. We cannot be afraid. Hey, this is what Jesus did. See, I don't know what God you pray to, but my God, he was born in Nazareth in a stable where horses and donkeys and cows, okay, would drink water out of this stable. It was stinky. It was smelly. He stepped into our mouth. He was not afraid to do that. And that's what we want to have first, so sanitized and so clean. If Jesus were to come back right now, and he would look around and say, oh, what's all that? Because I'm sorry, and I know the pastor doesn't want to hear this right now, and it's okay, but my question is this: God forbid, if this church, if this building, because we are the church, if this building were to burn down tomorrow, God forbid, would you be willing to have to celebrate my baptism? I say that to my people all the time. I'm like, you see, this is just a building. And you know what? The roof is collapsed on our head, and we don't have enough money to repaint it or whatever, but guess what? This is not the church. We are the church. Because it seems like today when we do renovate, it will say something. Well, you know what? We need to go to the money for the most thing. Do you think our ancestors, when they were going to mass in the catacombs, said, oh, I'm sorry, I can't go to the money for today. I'm not God's practice. And then out. No, you know what? I'm going to say this publicly. The teaching, right? Amen? I really believe that we have right now way too many ministries. What would have happened if we would have consolidated that and do what the church fully wanted? Would it work to feel different? If God forbid a final custom master for it. And that comes to so horrible. He's cut my full of minutes. I've been going to mass for the last 56 years. Maybe you need to change something. No, but the problem is this. That's what is happening. In age, the masses were intended to be an optional thing. It developed into that because of how fast we breathe. And so there was a 7 o'clock, and then there was 8 o'clock, and then there was 9 o'clock, and then there was 10 o'clock, Italian mass. And then there was a musician. Well, because the church was growing, but guess what? We're not there anymore. Do you see what I'm saying, that we're doing church wrong? Because guess what? Then we have 5 witnesses, and we have, you know, 25 people, we have 50 people, we have 100 people. Wow, what would have happened if we were to get 800 people together? And we would have worshiped differently. And we would have said, hey, guess what? The youth is not doing well. How do we call it? That's a crazy concept. I support that priest. You know what? We're not starting to come to everybody's youth. So say, can a man dream? Now, if you're chronically late, it doesn't apply to you, okay? But I'm being very serious. Listen to the words of the bishop to you. A robust faith formation. Robust. You know what the problem is with Catholics? Once you do confirmation, you're faced. You're faced. You are the weakest link. Goodbye. Think about this. Think about this. Don't raise your hand because I don't want you to be embarrassed on public television. What was the last time you took up a course that was offered in your class? A Bible course. What was the last time you actually learned something new? Besides the encounter school. No offense to the encounter school. You know I love encounter, I wouldn't be here. You know that. But I'm being very serious. You see, if a priest were to say, we're going to offer a 7-week workshop on Mariology. There you go. Right? We're going to offer a 7-week course on the Catechism of the Catholic Church. We're going to offer a 7-week course on the meaning of the Mass. Jesus says, you guys want miracles to happen. You know, like, well, you know, that priest, that preacher's voice. You get to be putting up and preach. And now, it's easy to criticize, but guess what? Now, pay attention. How are you helping the parish priest? I'm going, hey, Father, what am I going to do? But maybe next time, something to do. Hey, you know what? This is in the time of the Prince of the Prince. Can you have a cup of coffee together? Because most of you, you are
believe. I know we suffer too. Because we need the Holy Spirit. Amen.